1995. Please have a seat, relax, enjoy yourself. First item on this evening's agenda, one is minutes of the previous meeting, December 20th, 1994. Any questions? Mr. Edsel?
Page 4. Last paragraph. I'm not sure that. 2,000-gallon tanks. And on page number 5, second paragraph, second line, sometimes Alice writes like Dr. Seuss, and I think it's really great style, but I didn't fully understand. So the minute is a compliment, Alice. Now the onus is on, is it the new septic system, or is it someone else uphill whose system has gone bad? I understand what, but I think we're missing a word in there, and I can't figure out.
Which paragraph?
Second paragraph, second line. Mr. Carlson may remember what he was saying then.
I think if you just put dashes after "now the onus is on --" because I think then I think he asked the question, is it the new septic
The question,
system,
maybe capitalize the second is.
Right.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is it the new septic? I read it now. Okay. Green eggs and ham. That's all I have.
Okay. Anyone else? Have a motion?
To adopt the minutes as corrected?
Mm-hmm.
Second.
All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Unanimous. Next on item on this evening's agenda is correspondence. Wherever I put it. First item is a letter that the Planning Board received from In By The Sea, subsequent to their having received a permit to put a small addition on and going through a consent agenda item. Both the owner of the inn as well as the entire front office staff was very appreciative of the swiftness of the review and the fairness of the review. And while we don't receive too many letters like that, we certainly appreciate them. So I hope the board takes it to heart, and we appreciate the favorable comments. We try to keep things balanced. Second item is a DEP informational sheet of 1994 regarding water quality assessment. A memorandum to the code enforcement officer regarding the school project tree protection. Having worked on several of these projects, including one which is under construction, it's almost an ongoing situation where as materials come onto a site and access has to be gained to a site, that it's easy to encroach upon the existing trees. And we wanted to send a gentle reminder to the school department to be sure that the trees are protected per the plan. There's an environmental and development newsletter dated December 1994, and a report of the Planning Board activities from 1994, which is very interesting to look at because we get to witness a Planning Board almost as like grass growing or ice melting. And I think just for the public's benefit, the Planning Board is sometimes criticized for the difficult process of dealing with us. But in 1994, we approved close to 20 projects, in addition, much through the work of our volunteers serving on committees, as well as many, many hours of discussion and deliberation in our workshops. We recommended to a council the sewer ordinance amendments, planning board goals, town center zone, a major effort from last year, an important change to the ordinance was the associate member status, and lastly recommended at the last planning board the December council meeting was the accessory dwelling unit amendments. So I thank the board for that hard work and appreciate all the efforts that went in 1994. In 1995, I think, is going to be equally as busy. Under other business, First item on this evening's agenda is election of officers. We have discussed this in workshop, and I guess what we would like to do is to discuss an appointment for the vice chair.
And the chair.
And the chair. How would the board like to proceed with this?
I'd like to make a nomination for chairman. I'd like to nominate Tom Emery serve again for a full year this time, not just a partial year. I think we all feel that he did a remarkable job, so I think he should be allowed to continue.
Thank you.
Second.
I'll abstain from the vote. Any other discussion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously with one abstention. That would, thank you very much. Very much appreciated. The other appointment would be for vice chair. This position fills a chair in the event that the chair is unable to serve through the entire year or sits in substitution for the chair when the chair is unable to make a meeting or has a conflict of interest. Do I have a nomination for the vice chair? I will nominate. Go ahead, Mark.
I would like to nominate Stephen Parkhurst for vice chair in recognition of his very able service to the planning board over the past several years.
All right. Thank you. And as a matter of fact, Steve most likely would be nominated as chair this evening if he didn't have other obligations. It doesn't allow him the opportunity to serve as a full-time chair.
Second.
Second. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Right. One abstention. Right. Passes unanimously. He didn't vote against himself. That's a good sign. Before we proceed, I would like to thank Maureen O'Meara, the town planner, who makes the job as chair look extremely easy. Essentially, I sit here and just pass questions back and forth and act as a facilitator. It's Maureen that does 99% of the work, reviews the projects in tremendous detail, prepares the notes for the evening meetings and the options of motions, and gives us each a gentle needle or a shove when we're off key during the meeting, or the public needs to be reminded for showing up to testify and so forth. I'd like to thank Alice for her continued good work. I don't know how you transcribe what's said during a meeting into two or three pages of notes. For anyone who's tried to do it, it's not an easy task, and that's appreciated very much. And I'd also like to thank all the board for, I think, your very fair deliberation and contribution throughout the year, and I think your commitment for all the time that's placed in all the workshops and the late evening meetings. I think there are some boards who probably wouldn't put up with such a requirement, but it's very much appreciated by myself as well as the town. So with that, let's press ahead. Under the first item under new business is our anniversary project. It's Bluestone Earth Materials Removal Permit Renewal, a request by Jim Murray for an earth materials removal permit renewal for the Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road. This is reviewed under Section 19-3-8. Maureen, would you like to give us a little more background on this?
Yes. Under zoning ordinance, if you wish to remove earth materials, which is defined as essentially anything but topsoil, you have to receive an annual permit from the planning board called an earth materials removal permit. Before you receive that permit, you need to hold a public hearing. It has been the tradition of the board that the public hearing has automatically been scheduled when the permit is up for renewal. Mr. Leela Murray is here to represent Bluestone Quarry, and I'm sure he'd be happy to answer any questions. There are two issues I may want to just bring up for you. The proposed motion that you have is the same motion you do every year with minor changes. Mr. Murray has brought up two issues that he would like the board to address. One of them is that the approval would restrict him to removing no more than 1,000 cubic yards of material. It's under number 9. In the past, he has never removed more than 1,000 cubic yards of material, although you've given him approval for 10,000. He would like to continue to receive the same approval he always receives, which is for 10,000 cubic yards. The only other issue, I believe he's related, is under item number 6. where he's restricted to not operating any equipment before 9 in the morning, and he would like to be able to start his compressor equipment at 7 in the morning.
7:30, come on.
Maureen, would you just back up to the cubic yardage? It says 1,000 cubic yards. It's 1,000 cubic yards per year, up to a maximum of 10,000.
All right. If you were to approve this as written, it would be a maximum of 1,000.
Okay.
Every year you've approved 10,000. I revised it to 1,000 because of some past dealings Mr. Murray has had with the DEP. But he would like it to remain at 10,000. So you may want to consider that and just add another zero to that particular number.
Okay. Since this is a public hearing, Mr. Murray, would you please come to the podium and introduce yourself and just give us a brief discussion, and then we'll open it up to the public for comment.
Thank you, Tom. My name is Jim Murray, president of Bluestone Corporation. I'm requesting the annual permit to operate the quarry for another year. I have walked the area and checked the fences. No problems there. I've put up the usual 5 or 6 extra signs that I have to do every year because they like to take them down and put them in the bedroom. So those are back up again. And to my knowledge, there have been no complaints. We've blasted 6 times over there this year and plan to operate it as we did last year.
Okay. Thank you. What I'll do at this time, since this is a public hearing, is open the meeting up to the public for comment. Any members of the public that wish to speak about this project?
You have a business card?
Seeing and hearing none, I will close the public hearing. And at this time, open it up for board discussion or questions. Ms. Parkhurst?
Just one question. What is the DEP issue that you brought up in the introduction?
Apparently, and you correct me if I get this wrong, if you remove more than 1,000 cubic yards of rock from a quarry, it kicks in a new level of DEP review where you have to do a lot more reporting requirements. As long as you keep it under 1,000 cubic yards, it's a much lower level of review. That's the only issue that came up. Mr. Murray didn't want to go into that next level, and there was some confusion because the board had actually approved him for 10,000, although he had removed less than 1,000.
Correct.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Yeah. Edsel?
Murray, do you expect to remove more than 1,000 cubic yards?
No.
When was the last, I was just trying to, I've seen this for at least 7 years, but I don't know when the last time the outline or an estimate of the edge of blasting or whatever, the edge of removal, was actually entered on here by an engineer or surveyor. I think in 1993 or so, you started, 92 is when you started.
Mm-hmm.
Is your estimate of 1995, it looks to be a little more than 1,000, a little more than what you did this year. Is that reasonable
no.
to assume,
no.
or just approximately the same?
Just approximately the same.
Okay.
Just a freehand drawing, so.
I could tell that.
Any other questions? Mr. Carlson?
Yes, I have a question about the 7:30 a.m. from 9. The noise level, this machinery or equipment, is that about equal to, I understand here you've had trucks starting at 7:30, and they're certainly noisy. I assume the machinery or equipment you're asking to start as early as 7:30 is relatively quiet?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And what time of the day do you usually dynamite or use?
Whenever we get the holes drilled.
So is that during the day sometime? Can it be at 7:30?
No, we don't blast at 7:30, no.
No. Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions? While we're on that subject, Maureen, the abutters were notified of this request to change the time as part of the notification.
No, they just get a general notice that says his permit is up for renewal.
Have you, any other questions of the board? Jim, have you run this equipment earlier than 9 o'clock in the past? I don't in violation.
Yeah, maybe 8:30.
Is it really necessary to have it as early as 7:30? Would 8 o'clock be adequate?
Yeah, I'd have no problem with that.
Okay.
I'd just like to get things warmed up so we can get going by 9 o'clock, because if we start at 9, we don't get going alone. Mm-hmm. There isn't much of the day left in the afternoon, so.
I don't know how the rest of the board feels like about that, but 7:30 is just a little bit before people are out of bed in some cases. It seems a little early for compressing equipment. Mr. Edsel?
I don't think it's any different than a lot of compressor equipment that's on construction, residential construction sites. And I think there is a town ordinance about beginning work before 7 o'clock in the town of Cape Elizabeth for outdoor labor. I haven't seen it. I was told that by a contractor myself. But a lot of those compressor units, whether they're using jackhammers or other large compressor units, would be the same units, I think. Mm-hmm. Is that what you're talking about?
Yeah.
The compressor, same
thing we did at the school. We started at 7 o'clock, quit 4:30.
Mm-hmm.
The only difference I would see here is that this is an ongoing single-site operation versus something that's ephemeral or of that nature, like a stream. It's here one day, it's not the next. Has there been any complaints registered at Town Hall with respect to this operation?
No, I call the police. I check with the police chief every year, and there's been no complaints regarding the operation.
Okay.
I'd just like to note that there was a suggestion from the town engineer that that Mr. Murray update the plan as of next year, and wanted to know whether you had any difficulty with that suggestion.
No.
Okay, good. The only other comment that I've heard, and this is just someone had mentioned to me in passing, was an issue of noise in the area, but I believe that noise was associated, and Jim, you can correct me if I'm wrong here, but there was the recycling of pavement on a construction project in this area was done on your property,
right?
But it was somebody else's equipment.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that's the only comment a neighbor offered me. Any further questions or discussion? I have a motion. Mr. Edsel.
A motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, the applicant operates Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road. Number two, this facility requires a special permit to remove earth materials under section 19-3-8. Number three, the facility will conduct blasting and transportation and transport operations which could endanger the public health, safety, and welfare. Number four, the applicant has substantially addressed the requirements needed for issuance of a special permit for removal of earth materials. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans, materials submitted, and the facts presented in the application of Leland Murray for a special permit for removal of earth materials at the Bluestone Quarry located at 1019 Sawyer Road be granted by the Planning Board for a one-year period beginning January 18, 1994 and ending on the regular January 1996 meeting of the Planning Board, subject to the following conditions.
Excuse me, could I correct that to January the 18th, 1995?
Yeah, the first date should be 95.
Thank you. Number one, give me a chance to take a breath. The applicant shall keep accurate records of any and all blasting operations, including times and dates for such operations and for information on size and placement of all charges. Number two, all blasting shall be performed by or under the direction, personal supervision of a person qualified, experienced, and regularly engaged in such work and shall be done in a manner which will not endanger the health or safety of any person or damage any real or personal property on or off the quarry site. Representatives of the applicant shall be present at the time of the blasting operation. Number three, the applicant shall maintain comprehensive general public liability insurance with coverage of not less than $500,000 per person and per occurrence for bodily injury or death, and not less than $100,000 per occurrence for property damage. The schedule for any blasting and drilling shall be submitted by the applicant to the police department at least 7 days prior to the commencement of the work. The schedule shall include the name of the drilling and or blasting subcontractor will perform the work and a certificate of insurance for such subcontracting. Schedule shall be approved by the police chief prior to the commencement of the work. Drilling and blasting shall be scheduled for no more than 1 half-day at a time. Number five, no operation shall be conducted at the quarry on Saturdays, Sundays, or holidays, except that stone may be loaded and trucked from the site on Saturdays. Number six, no machinery or equipment shall be operated before 7:30 a.m. or after 6 o'clock p.m. on any day, except the loading of trucks shall only take place between 7:30 a.m. and 4:30 p.m. Number seven, fencing and appropriate signs shall be maintained. The applicant shall maintain at least 12 signs, three on each side of the property, reading, danger, no trespassing. Eight, the applicant shall make a reasonable attempt to notify Cape Elizabeth residents along Sawyer Road and Stillman Street in the vicinity of the quarry prior to any blasting operation. Number nine, no more than 10,000 cubic yards of material should be removed during the term of this permit. Number 10, if the police chief finds at any time that the health, safety, or welfare of area residents or property is threatened by quarry operations, he is authorized and directed to work that, let me reread that. He is authorized and directed to order that all work at the site be suspended immediately and to require that operations be resumed only after further action by the planning board.
Second.
The motion's been seconded. Any discussion?
I'd like to make an amendment, or propose an amendment to the motion, which is that in number six, that a comma be placed after 4:30 p.m. And the words inserted, "and operation of compressor equipment can begin as early as 8 o'clock a.m."
Do you have any problem with that, Mr.?
Well, I think that if it's a consensus of the board that rather wait to start compressor equipment, then it just, why not just change in the first sentence, no machinery or equipment, to 8 o'clock a.m.? I mean, if that's a consensus of the board.
The board for 8 o'clock? I do, okay.
I'd agree to change that without adding another.
Okay.
Sort of contradicts or sets aside one more category of equipment.
And you had, or after, you changed that to 4:30 by implication? No?
Eight to six and 7:30 to 4:30.
Okay. Have a motion been amended, seconded?
Yeah. Second as amended.
Okay. Any further discussion? The only comment I want to make is that, Jim, you understand that if the board votes favorably on this motion, including the 10,000 cubic yards of material, that still in no way implies that you don't have to get a DEP permit when you reach whatever threshold it is that the DEP requires.
I understand that.
Okay.
After 1,000 cubic yards, it becomes another permit.
Yep. Okay. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously.
Thank you.
Congratulations. The next item under new business is a Jones public access waiver, a request by Thomas and Lisa Jones for a public access waiver for lot U27-10-2 located on Spurwink Avenue. This is reviewed under section 19-4-2B. Maureen, a little background.
This originally was a public access waiver approved by the board in 1989. It was called the Rutherford public access waiver at the time. And two public access waivers granted, one for each of the lots. Mr. Jones requested that put this map up on the board, but if you can see the area colored in, the lawn area that is supposed to be filled in of wetland, just below that area is where the original building envelope was proposed to be. Mr. Jones would like to move the building envelope to a place at a higher elevation on the lot. So that's why he's coming before the board this evening to request that movement of that building envelope. And since 1989, there's been a lot of changes, so we've got some other requests being made regarding the width of the road and the amount of gravel base that would have to be placed, the width of the radius as you turn onto this lot, and also there may be some issues regarding impact on wetlands.
Thank you. Would the applicant care to just make a brief presentation, then we'll have questions?
Hi, my name is Thomas Jones from Jones Home Healthcare. I don't pass up a little opportunity to do some advertising. I think this map here, you should take a quick look at it. This was your original.
Just to be clear, you're applying as a single-family, non-commercial permit.
Yes, it's for my wife and I, and I have the property currently under contract with Mr. Marcuzzi here.
Okay.
And before I purchased the property, I wanted to move the building envelope, which was down here in a very, very wet area, kind of a valley, and didn't have much of a view, and I wanted to move it into the middle of the 5 acres up on a nice grassy knoll. It just seemed to make a lot more sense. And I wanted to have that in writing before I bought the property in case there was any trouble. You understand my caution. And I'd like you to give you a copy of the old map to show you where the old building envelope was here in the area that they had planned and approved to fill. A nice comparison.
Anything else?
No.
You're planning just a single-family house here?
Yes, sir. Yep.
Garage?
Yes, I would like a garage.
Does the garage fit within the possible house site footprint that's indicated on
that
the...
That square that's indicated there is 100 by 80, which would be a gigantic house. Yeah, a hotel, actually. That square is about the same size as the lots you see adjacent to the stone wall. Or stone wall that runs along Pleasant Street. See the stone wall? This is Pleasant Street here, and these are individual lots. Mm-hmm. This is an area where you see this possible. You can have your house anywhere within the square, 100 by 8. I think it's 100. This is
okay.
5 acres here.
Mr. Jones?
Yes.
You're going to have to remain at the podium and address the entire board at one time.
Okay.
And if you need something to hang up on the board, we could do that. This time what I'll do is just turn it over to the board for questions. Anybody have any questions, comments, or concerns? Mr. Edsel?
Mr. Chairman, I would just ask that while we have the opportunity to clean up the plan, since there's not going to be assuming that we approve a new building envelope, that we remove from the plan the authorization to fill some wetlands. Just remove that cross-hatching from the plan itself. That's no longer needed, and I don't think we need to approve filling of some wetlands. I just note that I think this what we call the upland edge of the wetlands, I think was indicated by the owner at the time, Don Rutherford. There's not really a professionally flagged wetland area. I didn't see on the plan anywhere where it was, but I just assume that we're well within. I guess my question is to the planner, does this coincide with whatever records the building, the code enforcement officer might have with plan for wetland areas?
The code officer has looked at this plan and decided that is the wetland.
Reasonably, okay. Other things to clean up, there's a typo down in the Rutherford lot itself. We might as well clean up where it says covenant shall bind the owner. It's OWW, it should be OWN, owner.
And covenant is spelled without two N's.
Covenant. I also asked the planner, is there any record of the covenant required being recorded 90 days after this approval, within 90 days of the approval?
I have records of the covenant having been reviewed and approved by the town attorney. I'm going to have to go through the file to see whether it was actually...
It was a condition of the original approval at the time, and we should make sure that second time through, at least they did it the first time.
I was not aware that the covenant had a 90-day deadline on it. Mm. I believe I may be wrong in my understanding, but I thought it was a covenant had lots.
Right. And Section H of the motion, that a covenant incorporating the above-mentioned conditions shall be inserted in all the deeds on all three lots.
Right.
Maybe I read that to mean that covenant...
And I do have copies of the language that was supposed to be inserted in the deeds, and that has been approved by the town attorney.
I guess I'd ask the applicant approximately in the location of where the previous building envelope was. There's a statement that says town water sewer to septic tank pumped to leach field. Or can I understand the last half of that sentence, but and it is on, I believe, on the original, but Do we know what that sentence means, that note to the file, what note to the plan means?
It was my understanding that it was optional whether you wanted to use septic, public sewer or have a septic system. Is that what you're...
I'm just reading the note, and my only comment is, while we have it here for approval, let's
okay.
make sure it reads correctly, and what we're trying to say.
Mr. Edsel, could
yes.
I just interrupt while
sure.
you're on that subject? Maureen, the council, I believe, voted on the sewer ordinance at the last meeting.
At the last meeting, the council voted to send the sewer ordinance amendments to public hearing
okay.
at the February meeting, so that there are no, apply. Nothing's been
okay.
adopted yet.
Okay, thank you. Sorry, Steve, go ahead.
I guess I'll again yield to the planner to see if there's some sense we can bring to that. Either we leave the note on the plan or take it off. Does anybody else have the same problem reading that sentence as I do?
I think it should be deleted. It doesn't seem to apply to anything that's left.
The applicant has submitted an HHE 200 form. He's designed a system that's been accepted by the code officer, and it appears that you're going to be using a septic system, not town sewer, so I question the need to even have that note on there.
Right. I guess if we remove that note, then also on lot one, I think a similar note. Mm-hmm. Lot number one, town water or well, sewer to septic, leach gravity. I suppose that maybe we leave that note, leaving in hieroglyphic form the right for that person to potentially hook to town sewer?
That lot is under separate ownership.
Yeah, okay.
They built up the
right.
existing
so we're not, that's not even the yeah. content of what we're dealing with here. I had two suggestions. Strike the cross-hatching in the wetlands to be filled and the typos mentioned in both the what was the rough for the lot and the one just above that. Strike it from the plan.
Okay.
I have no other questions.
Anybody else have any questions, comments?
I'd just like to add that covenant also shows up in another place on lot two. The legend at the back side of the lot needs to be cleaned up with respect to that word as well.
Boy, I'm glad I didn't draw that map.
It appears to me that we haven't discussed all of the comments that the town engineer
right.
has made.
You haven't.
And Maureen, is there any particular reason why we don't have more of those referenced in the proposed motion?
No. Are there any particular?
I guess I was interested in the alteration of the turnaround so that one leg of the turnaround wouldn't be impacting the upper edge of the wetlands.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a problem?
No.
Okay.
There's plenty of room there to position it any way you'd like it. I took the plan to the person who draws the plan and said we need to, I originally took it to the fire chief and I asked him what he wanted. And I showed him the map and there was a T on lot one, as you can see, that abuts the building envelope. And he said, give me one of those here. And I said, okay. And then I took it to the person who draws maps, and I said, give me one of those here. And that's what he did. And the dimensions are actually slightly larger than the ones on lot one.
Well, perhaps one way of short-circuiting this would be to say, have you reviewed the town engineer's letter of January the 9th, and do you have any problems with any of the suggestions?
I don't have any problems with it, no. No.
Then I think what we could do is just suggest that the new plan, when it's submitted, incorporate all mm-hmm. of those suggestions.
From my understanding, there's no, because it's not a road, it's a driveway,
mm-hmm.
and you don't have any set standards for driveway. Your set standards for a driveway are 22 feet wide, which is a bit absurd, I guess. So any 16 or 18 is more what people use, and I drew the number 16 thinking that would be plenty wide enough, because I live on a 16-foot road already, and I should have guessed for 18, but I did wrong.
I don't have any other
flip the coin
comments.
Mr. Chairman.
Ms. Parkhurst.
On the plan that's before us, it appears that the turnaround is partially over the septic system leach field.
Mm-hmm.
It seems to me if a heavy truck goes in there, since they're plastic chambers, there's going to be a problem.
I would think so.
So it, it seems to me that the tee has to be moved to get it away from that at the very least. And then by accomplishing that, you could move it away from the wetlands as well.
Two birds with one stone.
Excuse me?
Two birds with one stone. That makes
right.
sense. 90 degrees he was talking about.
Any other questions or comments? I'll just put in a comment. You have 5 acres here. For some reason, someone's decided that the best place to put the house is pointed into two people's backyards rather than to look out over the back 40 of your own property, so to speak, which would still afford you a southerly exposure on the front. You can put the house where you feel like it within the setback provisions, but I think if the house were relocated and shifted a little bit, you'd have more than enough room there. I'm not familiar with the site. I don't know if it's wet every inch beyond this building on.
Not at all, no. I thought that was kind of in the middle. I mean, when you're standing in the middle of a field with a surveyor, you're going, where are we now?
Mm-hmm.
And you said, oh, this looks good. And I said, put a square here. I suppose I should have been more specific, but I thought that was his job, if you know what I'm saying. So he drew
yes.
the square in, and we could have our house within that square.
Yeah, you can have it as close to one side as you want and so forth.
Yeah, and facing, I hope to face it towards the south myself.
Okay. I guess that's the only other comments I have. To pick up on Mr. Parker's issue about removing the note on the area to be filled, the engineer comments that there's no topography shown on the plan, so there's no way of knowing exactly how much fill is going to be required. I believe that you probably, if this is drawn to scale and is accurate, that you're going to end up having to fill some of that wetland near the first bend in the driveway that comes in very close to the edge of the gravel, as depicted on the plan.
Could I? I want to come up and see what you're. Before I talk again, I'll walk back.
And this, I got.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
This area right here.
Yeah.
Does the board understand the area that I'm referring to? So I don't know how many square feet that is, but perhaps the area to be filled is going to be more like 100 or 200 square feet rather than 3,500. Without going back through my notes, Maureen, is this any other provisions on this wetland? Is there any setback lines that need to be noted on this plan, 100 or 150 feet?
Code officer has made a determination that it's acceptable under the zoning ordinance.
I see. Okay. That's one of those things. A wink is as good as a nod, right?
I say.
Okay.
I think you'll find there is a letter in there from the code officer.
All right. Any other questions of the board? Mr. Edson.
It was just left unclear to me. Was the intent to try to reorient the hammerhead turnaround so that it's not located over the both on both ends? We have one end is wetlands, which, being well aware of the 1989 approval process, that was not a there's no real edge there. In other words, there's nothing flagged there.
Mm-hmm.
The HE200 doesn't indicate that there's any driveway over or impervious surface over the septic tank, so that's not part of that plan. Are we looking to reorient that hammerhead?
Move it away so there's no fill required in the wetland and so that it clears the septic
system. Septic, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
I will say, the comment made about going over the plastic chambers, that was an issue in public access waiver down off from Old Ocean House Road.
Right. Yep.
And we were told that they withstand that weight.
If you get the right kind of chambers,
yeah,
you can
you
do
get
that.
Concrete chambers.
Yeah.
Concrete, yes. Right. I mean, they were telling us that the plastic, the issue really is number one, they get crushed. Number two, these types of systems work by evaporation. And if you cover it with an impervious covering, it just doesn't work. Anyway. No other questions or comments.
Okay. Do I hear a motion? Ms. McKay?
A motion for the board to consider findings of fact. Number one, Thomas and Lisa Jones are requesting a public access waiver for lot U27-10-2 to relocate a previously located building envelope which requires review under section 19-4-2B. Two, an adequate gravel base supporting the designated access points is necessary to allow emergency vehicles to travel to the site. Three, the plan substantially complies with the requirements of the zoning ordinance. Therefore, be it ordered that based on the plans and materials submitted, the request of Thomas and Lisa Jones for a public access waiver to lot U27-10-2 located off Spurwink Avenue be approved, subject to the following conditions. One, that the driveway for lot two include a gravel base with a minimum width of 18 feet subject to support, sufficient to support town emergency vehicles. The radius turn from the right-of-way to lot two driveway shall be increased to 25 feet with a gravel base. Gravel bases in excess of the 20-foot radius and the 16-foot wide driveway may be loamed and seeded. Two, that all of the conditions set forth in the town engineer's letter of January the 9th, 1995, which the applicant has a copy of, also be observed. Including but not limited to the reorientation of the proposed turnaround to exclude contact with the existing wetlands as well as the proposed septic system. And three, that the plans must be revised and submitted to the town planner and town engineer for approval prior to the issuance of a building permit and or any alteration of the site as of this date. Yes.
Did you want to talk about the corrections, the typographical corrections and the notes you had asked have changed?
Yes, thank you. I guess I would add that as a part of number three, that the plans must be revised to include, as set forth above, and also including typographical, the corrections of typographical and other mistakes and the removal of inappropriate legends.
Mr. Parkers?
Do we want to change the area to be filled for lawn to have it word something about fill for driveway? You know, to be limited to, say, 350, 400 square feet, whatever is going to be necessary to build the driveway as depicted on the plan.
Mm-hmm.
If you want to make that in the form of an amendment to the motion, I'd be perfectly happy to accept it.
Could we add an item four?
Sure.
So with deleting the note that refers to fill for lawn of approximately 3,500 square feet and providing a note for the appropriate fill
to build the driveway as depicted on the plan.
If we could refer to removing the cross-hatching as well, but yeah. And just a note to approximately in that area of the right-of-way. It's difficult without contours to see how much would be filled, but you would assume that since
it's not
going to
be more than
400
square feet. It's
relatively flat there.
400 square feet.
Okay.
I'd also like to add another note to that motion. That the revised plan show dimensions for locating the building window and the house site. There's no way of knowing where that is on the plan unless you scale it. And in order to locate the house or the house site, there should be some dimensions that tie that down on the face of the earth.
Except.
Okay. Any further amendments?
Second as amended.
Okay. The motion's been seconded, amended. All those in favor indicate by raising your right hand. Passes unanimously. Thank you.
I have a question.
Go
so
ahead.
Prior to getting a building permit, I answer the five notes that you've made.
Prior to getting a building permit, you will meet with the town planner and go through the amended. She will write a letter. A letter will come from you to you from the board that will state the motion.
Okay.
And you should meet with the planner and or the code enforcement officer, the town planner to deal with the issues that were discussed this evening.
Okay.
The code enforcement officer for any other additional issues that may have come to bear.
Okay.
But the plan has to be resubmitted and approved by the planner, the engineer, and the code enforcement officer before
okay.
you start construction or receive a building permit.
Because it could be conceivably 5 years.
Before you build a house?
Yeah. I mean, I hope not, but...
I would suggest you get the plan into the
depends
planner
on the economy.
As soon as possible, regardless
yeah.
of when you
right,
plan to build a house.
Right, that was my question. This should be taken care of right now, not
yes.
5 years from
yeah.
now. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Any other... That ends this evening's agenda. Mr. Edsel.
I just have a couple comments to make, and it has to do primarily with a school project in the tree preservation plan. And I understand that how sites get used and so forth, and I was the one that mentioned it at first. I'd like to pursue the issue of the tree preservation specifically, as it states in this memo between the middle school and Scott Dyer Road. There are a couple of hardwood trees there that are simply going to be lost, and it's just a case of housekeeping. Moving one concrete form truck over 8 feet, not parking on the roots of several other trees. It was part of that plan to retain those. And if we lose those hardwood trees, that's losing 20, 25 years worth of growth because they're very nice shade trees. I through the planner, I'd ask that we follow up on that. Along the same vein, I don't want to be picky. At the same time, there's this sense of why do we go through all this whole process of approving site plans if they don't get followed? A question on the Fleet Bank facade change. And I did question Maureen this afternoon on that. Was there any, and I didn't participate in that, but I feel free to ask questions about it, and that I didn't recollect any lighting change. Fleet has put their own halogen lamp light on the side of the building, and there are already four sort of standard lighting fixtures already on that through CVS down through Kinder Corner. And I would think it most appropriate if they're going to make a lighting change, number one, that should have been part of the plan to approve. Number two, if they do that without approval, at least they... I don't know how to enforce that now. It does look odd. I don't know if anybody else has noticed it. It's a very bright halogen lamp. And there are four other much dimmer, sort of like 1950s.
I congratulate you for getting past the facade itself.
Anyway, if the planner could look into that with the approval, I suppose, of the chair. And while I'm on the site plan approval binge here, the Cumberland Farms site plan included, the site plan approval itself did not include a vacuum stand where you vacuum cars, and didn't include moving the air compressor unit out to what is really the apex of that site. The apex of the intersection site. My recollection is that the site plan approval did approve 9 lamps under the canopy. They have 12. I don't know what kind of pressure we as a board or a town can place on an applicant. My understanding also that the sidewalk is not completed on the Scott Dyer Road side. I just, as a planning board, we go through all of these site plan approvals with some detail and sometimes too much detail, but we do it for a reason. And I think if the applicants don't do that, then we should have some vehicle to to make sure it gets done. Otherwise, why should we be here? And it's not a case of being overly picky. It's the case that they move a shrub 5 feet or miss a couple shrubs here or whatever. That's one issue. But adding more to the site or not following plans of it, we made as conditions, I think, something to follow up on. And I guess I'd just ask that through the planner we make those communications.
We did do one for the school. I support you 100%. I know that sometimes the enforcement issue is an issue from the standpoint of public goodwill and so forth. But I think you're absolutely right. If we're approving plans and we have certain conditions and things depicted on the plans, and then people are going beyond those plans and taking the opportunity of a construction period to sort of add things, and I'm not always convinced that applicants and the public in general are sensitive to the limitations that that the plan is limited to what's on the plan, that it's not time to get creative when one's in the field. I can say this, that as the chairman, I will work with the planner and send, I would prefer to have the correspondence come off the planning board's letterhead from the chair and not get the planner involved in interdepartmental issues. I think it is a planning board issue, not an interdepartmental issue. And send memos to Ernie as well as discuss them. And if there's any issue that is unresolvable because of the concern about enforcement, then I'll bring that back to the board and we can have discussions about whether we want to talk to the town manager or if it's necessary to do that.
It seems like it would, I certainly agree with both of you 100%, and it seems to me that it would be appropriate to, if there's some evidence that the plan has been deviated from in any substantial way, to ask the applicant to advise us probably in writing of the applicant's position with respect to compliance with all of the conditions, and then see what we get and take it from there.
You know, it seems that at the very least they should bring in a proposed change to a plan to the town planner, mm-hmm. Just at least put it, you know.
As a de minimis change.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think there are times when this board is seen as being anti-business, and I don't intend my comments to be in that manner at all. It's just that over the last 20 years and probably 3,000 different site locations that I've worked with, when things just aren't done right, that's where problems keep popping up, and there's no reason not to do them right from the start.
And I guess I would also say that if there's some reason why something couldn't have been constructed in the way in which it was suggested to start with, tell us about
yeah.
it. And I mean, you know, it's not as, I mean, I know we have a reputation sometimes of being a little bit hard to deal with, but I don't think we're that hard to deal with. We still haven't lost our reason. So I'd like to see if we couldn't get as much enforceable.
I think it's also helpful to recognize that the board represents a cross-section of the residents of the town of Cape Elizabeth, and as such, what concerns we may raise, other citizens are probably asking themselves as they go by the various projects. And I was interested to hear a couple of comments during the council meeting with respect to Shore Road, but concerning some of the other development approvals in the town center. So we're not wasting our time up here. There are people out there looking and thinking about all of the things that are done, and I think, as you said, Steve, it is important that things are implemented the way they're approved.
Taking this one step further, if an applicant builds something different that differs from the plans, I think I've asked this question before a couple of years ago, it doesn't seem we really have any mechanism for enforcement.
There certainly is a mechanism for enforcement. The code enforcement officer can inspect the site and notify the applicant that they're in violation of their permit. And depending upon the severity of the violation, procedures can then start in order to rectify the violations.
And at the very end of that, excuse me, Mr.
Go ahead.
I think it's conceivable that if a building is incorrectly constructed or constructed too close to a lot line or whatever, it literally, you know, at the very end of one end of the spectrum, it can actually be enforced to have it removed and reconstructed in a place that's appropriate. That would obviously not be the solution in every situation.
That did happen. The shed over by the school property wasn't part of the school application, but an abutter had built an addition to a shed that didn't have the correct setbacks, and the town allowed them to keep the original structure, but they were required to tear down the addition to the shed. So there is precedent.
Mr. Emery?
Yes.
Could we place this on a workshop agenda in the future and perhaps invite Mr. McVane to the meeting to voice our concerns? And as a new member, I'd like to hear more about this and see if we can tighten it up a little bit more.
Given the quickness of the year, I would like to do that sooner than later. We'll be discussing the ordinances, and that would seem to fit right in with that discussion. And catch Ernie before spring salmon run. I'll also, Maureen, the council chambers will be under renovation. Do you know what the schedule is? Will we be meeting here next month?
I haven't been told that you won't be meeting here.
Okay.
I know the cafeteria is out of bounds right now. There's a hole down there.
A big hole, yeah.
What's being done with the chamber?
It's being made handicapped accessible. This whole thing moves forward a few feet. Any other discussions, concerns? Mr. Retzel?
Move the meeting be adjourned.
Second.
All those in favor? Meeting adjourned. Thank you.
Is there some reason we got this? Yes, you should be adding that to your zoning ordinance. It's a replacement page.